The chair called it to order at 6 p.m.
6:02 to be precise.
All right, Mr. Skrzatski, thank you.
Welcome to our March 7th meeting. Just a point of interest, at 7 o'clock, we will be conducting a public hearing on our proposed FY17 budget. So stay tuned. So first order of business is to review and approve the minutes of February 11th.
Motion to approve the minutes.
I'll second that. All in favor? Aye. All right. Patty, you want to say anything about the warrants?
Yes, you do have 5 warrants tonight that total $25,626.29. And looking at our budget pages, our town appropriation budget pages 1 through 4, we're looking good. I do want you to know that this year to date, we have saved $3,934 on our fuel adjustment clause on our transportation contract. Last year's calculation didn't come till late, so that money will go directly to the town, but that was $2,887.25. I do have one concern. We've had some unexpected special ed costs come up in the budget. At this moment, we still don't know what the total will be to get us to the end of the year, and it could be problematic for the budget. The other thing I wanted to report was that we have an article on the special town meeting, which is a week from tonight, March 14th, and the select board approved the warrant, but the finance board did not. So on the 2nd of March, Don and I went to a finance committee meeting to explain to them what happened with our circuit breaker funds. So there's always been this rule that you shouldn't have more in your circuit breaker account than you earned that year. So it's not really, it is a revolving account, but there's a cap to it. But the DOR never enforced the rule. So this year, because of Governor Baker's early retirement incentive, there's all new people and they're enforcing every rule and we got no notification. So they took $26,939. Out of the circuit breaker account during the free cash audit done by the Department of Revenue. So we requested to have that back because that is how we're paying for our early childhood teacher this year. They had nothing to say, but they were appreciative of us coming and explaining why and how it happened. Mm-hmm. And that's all I have, unless anybody has some questions.
I did point out to him that should they not return that money to us if town meeting goes sour on us, that there's a likelihood, a very good likelihood, that we'll be back to the town for money because I don't know where we're supposed to come up with that 26 that we anticipated using in our FY16 budget. So, and they nodded their heads and we went on our way. So.
Has the warrant already been printed for the special town meeting?
Yeah.
It has. Okay. So it's showing that the finance board isn't recommending it?
I didn't see any, I don't remember, I got the copy of the warrant and I don't recall any of the recommendations being printed.
Didn't know they were there. That's how I found out that the finance
committee did not
approve it because that's
on
what
the
I
copy
called.
That I have.
I called Mark Prohinsky and I said, would it help if I came and explained to them what happened?
Okay.
Yeah, I thought for the most part the members were receptive with a couple exceptions.
Okay.
So we'll see how that plays out.
So didn't we also put a hold on the budget for this year in terms of
there
spending?
There is a freeze right now.
A freeze?
Yeah.
So, and that's to help with the special ed costs also?
Mm-hmm.
But we can't make up for all those costs, even with the hold.
Well, and we don't know yet. We're still waiting, as we talked about last month, on some evaluations. I met with the SPED director today, try to identify a couple of line items that we might be able to tap into in the special ed budget, but it's too early to speculate, I think, right now.
Once we get through heating season, we'll be in a much better position to tell you whether we're going to make it or not.
Okay.
Public comment? Joseph, do you have anything you want to ask us? Okay, moving to unfinished business, discussion and vote proposed FY17 budget. think we vote after the hearing.
You do, you do. So I was hoping what we could do tonight, because this is draft number four, and it has changed since we met again last month, is we could just walk through. Patty has a narrative of the summary of changes, and if we could just walk through those, and then if you had any specific questions after that, you want to?
Sure.
Does that make sense to all of you? Okay.
Yep.
I think the narratives you can certainly read at your leisure.
So we are presenting a fiscal 17 budget in the amount of $1,585,559. This is an increase from fiscal year 16 of $21,069, or 1.35%. This amount reflects the amount we will be requesting from a town appropriation. We will have additional funds of $387,360 from other grant and revolving account sources. That would bring the total operating budget of the Whately Elementary School to $1,972,919 in 2017. So going through the salary-related costs is a total net decrease of $19,048. We do have an increase in our contract bargaining agreements of $14,139. There is a contingency amount for unnegotiated raises with both union and non-union employees. But we do acknowledge the steps, and we have 13 teachers and instructional assistant, and those step increases will cost $12,729. We have one teacher who earned a new degree, which will add $660 to their paycheck. And then we had one instructional assistant who achieved the second step of longevity, and one instructional assistant who will be new to the scale, and that's an additional $750. As we had previously told you, that we are proposing to increase our daily sub rate from $65 a day to $75. Currently, we are the lowest paying district, and for substitutes, and with the increased usage of everybody using ASOP, we're finding it difficult to hire day-to-day subs.
What is ASOP?
ASOP is a program that we implemented last year. It tracks substitutes, so instead of us calling subs every day, we post our openings. And a lot of the other towns are using it too, so they shop.
Oh, okay.
But it does more than that. It actually tracks all employees' attendance and vacation and sick time as well. So it has a dual focus there, and it's worked out very well.
Yeah. And I can assure you that in the past month or so, we have seen days where we can't get us up,
right?
Which is new, very new. You know, when we first started with ASOP, how long have we had it?
Just our second year. It's our assets management system.
At the outset, it really worked very well. Mm-hmm. Not too many glitches, but lately we have had trouble. Yeah.
And that's because they can get on and see that, you know, like Mohawk maybe having the same job and they're paying more, so they'd rather take the Mohawk job than our job. Mm-hmm. So
this lease makes it more in the ballpark. Actually, it's still low. Most of them are up to $85 to $100 a day. So we keep saying that our district is attractive because it's an attractive district, but that only goes so far, though.
And then we have some changes in funding that total $40,633. Our early childhood teacher was funded mostly through the circuit breaker and the tuition revolving accounts. We will not have any circuit breaker funding next year, and the amounts in the revolving account has decreased because we're only running a half-day program. But we also moved both our music and art teachers from the school choice to the town appropriation, as was the request of the school committee. The decrease due to the changes, and we also have decreases due to changing in funding of $76,545. This year, Whately is going to see four retirements. We'll be replacing a grade one teacher, the school nurse, the school psychologist, and the guidance counselor, who's also the Spanish teacher. So we're using this opportunity to combine the psychologist and guidance positions into one. They will remain at a one FTE. They're both 0.5 and 0.5. But from these changes, we expect to save a minimum of $31,748. Also, due to changes in student individualized education plans, we anticipate having two less instructional assistants, which will also save us about $44,797. We have some other operational increases that net to $68,693. We have an increase in our central office expense of $3,847. We had some personnel who, central office personnel who were charged to grants, and that grant, one grant was lost and can no longer fund the early childhood coordinator. And the second was a change in the new federal grant laws. Unless you work 100% of the time on the grant, you can't charge the salary there anymore. So we had to take some of the central office staff off of that grant. Increase in out-of-district tuitions would be 27. We do have a possibility that we have a student going to an out-of-district placement. And as I said before, we're still awaiting the results of the 45-day assessment period. The increase in instructional service for the garden program, $5,500. This is not a new program to Whately, but which was also one that was affected by federal grant changes. This program is an essential part of the school's curriculum and also has a lot of community involvement. So we feel that it is very important that we continue to fund it, even though we lost the grant. Increase in medical and health services, $554. This is for the nurse's office. There's the EpiPens have been increasing, and we bought AED machines, and we never budgeted any money to replace the pads and the batteries, so we need to add that money. Increase in building maintenance and supplies, $4,000. This is because the increased cost of our custodial paper has been going up, you know, toilet paper, hand towels, and such. And we also added an amount to keep the roof inspected and maintained during the year. We also have an amount to cover central office insurance, retirements in Whately, and contract adjustments of $27,792. The cost of insurance for the district is 6.8%. So this is Whately's share of the central office personnel's insurance. We also have an amount due for retirement benefits for the staff that are leaving. And we've included a contingency amount, as I had told you before, for the unnegotiated salary changes. We do have some operational decreases that total $28,576. The first being our legal expense, we're saving $1,000. We are on a retainer for our school attorney, and they're cheaper than our previous one. But this is the last year, so I'm just saying FY18, now that they've had 3 years experience of us, when we renegotiate that contract, we could be looking at an increase in 18. We have a decrease of $6,072. Besides the expenses that I mentioned before, the insurance and the positions, Whately's share of the expenses decreased from 9.43% to 9.11%, which will save us $6,072. Based on 2 years of analysis of usage, not money spent, we will be able to reduce our building heat for $6,000. And I do want you to know that usually we go out to bid with the Lower Pioneer Valley Educational Collaborative for our gas bids. And it's a large collaboration of cities and towns. And this year, Springfield pulled out, and they were the weight of our purchasing power. So we were then all sort of left on our own. So we have three schools in the district that use gas: Whately, Deerfield, and Frontier. Whately was the only one that had assigned capacity. Deerfield and Frontier did not have assigned capacity. So we could have put the weight of the bid on Whately, but we decided that we're going to continually be in this position until we get Frontier and Deerfield their own capacity assigned. So we went separate, so that Frontier is getting, Whately is getting a lower rate because they had already had assigned capacity, and Deerfield and Frontier have sort of been left at market price because they need to get their capacity assigned.
What does that mean, sorry, assigned capacity?
As much as I can explain it, Katie, it means that that we've already, they know that we're gonna use a certain amount, mm-hmm. that we have used a certain amount. Of how much gas they're pushing through the lines, mm-hmm. how much capacity they need in the lines to push out the utilization. Mm-hmm. Am I explaining that right, Mr. Skrosky?
I think you're close.
Of course.
Close enough.
Close enough. Yeah, and I think Frontier has a problem because they also can burn oil.
Right.
And they go back and forth.
So that's why they don't have assigned capacity.
Right.
Okay, so our decrease in sped transportation, even with one possible sped, we can transportation to an out-of-district placement, we can save $3,600. Our regular transportation, we have a savings of $5,499. Our current bus contract has an annual COLA adjustment based on the Consumer Price Index for the Northeast Urban Area. And this year it came in at a negative 0.011%. So that calculates out to a savings of $5,499. And lastly, we're decreasing the textbook line by $4,905. As our curriculum moves more towards software and the utilization of instructional materials for learning, the textbook line should be reduced. And then we have a decrease in our sped instructional services of $1,500, and that's due to the matriculation of one of our sixth graders to Frontier. The FY17 school choice funds, our population has decreased to 34% this year, 44.8 students out of a total of 131. This will bring an estimated revenue of $243,559, and those are as of December DESE estimates.
How do you have 0.8 of a student?
Because
it's just when they calculate.
It's an FTE, so they stay.
They're only here for part of the year. Or something?
Correct. Yeah, and we had two students who were school choice and moved to town.
Okay.
So now they're not school choice.
I see. Okay.
And just for comparison, at the same time last year, you had 49.
Yeah.
Students.
I looked at some of the numbers.
Yeah.
Both in Whately and school choice are going mm-hmm. in.
So as a percent of the total budget, school choice should be providing about 12.35% of the budget, and this year it's carrying 17.62% of the budget in FY17. So we are no longer spending a year in arrears, it's like we're spending a year and a half, we're spending like a half a year in arrears, and we're spending a year and a half currently. And I think that's important to know, because at some point, the town's going to have to understand that we've been able to bring in 1%, 1.35%, but if we continue to go down in school choice numbers, these are essential services that we have on this budget. As you can see, our teacher specialist, which is the Spanish teacher, and our reading recovery teacher, our speech, we have instructional assistants, we have PT, OT, and part of our school psychologist. So these aren't costs that are going to go away just because school choice children decrease.
You're saying school choice decreased. I don't think it's decreased.
It has decreased.
The numbers have.
I have been.
From year to year, I think if you look at the last seven or eight years.
It was 49 down at this time last year, and this year it's 40. At this time it's 44. Okay. The problem is you have to look at it over a period of like 5 years.
I know.
So it's you know... it's tough to anticipate, but when you have an up year and then the next year is down and you're used to spending up.
Well, and the other part of the fact is that salaries grow and expenses grow.
And so school choice dollars
don't.
School
choice not changed.
And we're putting all our nuts in the basket
with
school choice. So.
Right.
So I'm anticipating next year, if we don't have a large influx of children, that we will definitely have a bigger budget increase than the 1.35 that we are able to sustain now. And I just think that our town people, our town leaders should know that.
Well, I think we need to remind them of that. Last year we were a little over 1%, and this year a little over 1%. And we can't keep doing that.
No.
But we're trying to be physically responsible. To the town, so
you're graduating six school choice students, so going to need to make up.
Our requests are, I would have to say, are average. We haven't had a major reduction in the amount of requests we get. The real issue is that at the end of the year, when we say, yes, we'll take you, it's whether or not somebody says, okay, we're coming to you, or we decided to go somewhere else, or we're staying put. Mm-hmm. So just the requests, you know, are an indicator, but
I know you do that by lottery.
Depending,
if someone's not picked, and someone is picked and they choose not to come,
go back on the other one.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Just for information point, Hatfield is also seeing a reduction in school choice applicants numbers. So I'm just thinking of the neighboring district that we often trade students back and forth. So it bodes watching.
And I think the trend is just that we're experiencing ourselves. There are less kids. So if there are less kids in Hampshire, Franklin County, there's going to be less choice.
Right.
And so for FY17, there will be no circuit breaker because we do not have any students that at this time currently enrolled that would allow us.
If that student that we've been talking about that may have to be tuitioned out, would that fall under circuit breaker or not?
It may or may not. The average this year is 40, I want to say it's close to 40,000.
Yeah.
We'd have to spend four times that, and I don't think that the options that are on the table right now would fit up.
Just ask them the question. I'm trying to find
question.
Money.
Yeah. It's a good question.
I can tell you, based on my discussion with the SPED director today, I don't think that is an option that you're going to have to be concerned about.
So then page 8 of 28 is the summary of changes that you can see there. And then pages 9 of 28 to 8:17, I believe, of 28 are the byline items, line items that detail the $21,069.
Can I ask that this changed, the percentage increase for the town went down a lot from the last draft. So what was the decision process in shifting more to the school choice?
We didn't shift more to the school choice. We decided that we would, that's what I highlighted on page. Every time I change something, Katie, I highlight it for you.
Some summary
so
changes.
So if you look at 8 of 28.
So it's that you found more savings.
By decreasing two FTE instructional assistants.
Okay. But it's putting more pressure on the school choice monies.
No, it's because I didn't add anybody over there.
Okay, well.
Hers was just a cautionary.
I guess I'm just wondering, and out loud, if we should we ask for more from the town? Or, I mean, this is pretty low at this point, or is it too low? Because I guess, could we go through the school choice monies? I'm very concerned that we actually are going to have enough money for the school choice next year.
Again, you're not spending what you're getting as you get it, okay?
I thought we were switching
you're
into that mode.
You're spending half.
About half.
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 We're only a half a year in arrears now. So I want you to take a look at page 18 of 28. So this is our budget. When I said that the total spending plan for FY17 would be the $1,000,009, this is how we're getting there. So our left hand, and this is a new worksheet to the budget.
Mm-hmm.
And so the left is the town appropriation. The next would be school choice, the early childhood revolving, the SPED grant, and total FY17 budget. Because I want you to see by line item how much we are spending. So if you go to 19, we still have no costs there. Page 20. So in school choice, we've got $77,582 for 1.2 specialists. We have a one FTE reading specialist and a 0.2 Spanish.
What page are you on?
20 of 28. And I'm looking in the second column.
I'm on 20 of 24.
Oh, so you're using a version you printed out.
Yeah.
The version, she has different page numbers.
That's what I asked before we met.
I'm sorry, I don't know why, what made the pages expand.
You can recycle this one, right?
Yeah.
That's slightly different.
I think, you know why? Because I put the narrative in there, Don. I'm sorry.
Oh, so the page has changed.
Yeah. So of 20 of 28, we're spending the $77,584 for the Spanish teacher and the reading specialist. Our speech teacher is paid from school choice. Our physical therapist is paid from school choice. Our occupational therapist is paid by school choice. Our paraprofessionals, we have $153,882 being spent from school choice. If you move over to the middle column, you'll see that $17,000 of our early childhood will be paid from the early childhood grant. And the SPED grant will provide another $22,728 to the instructional assistant line. So usually, Katie, when we would look at this before, you guys would look at instructional assistants and see $68,931 and think, oh, so we have four instructional assistants in the school. Well, no. In total, with all funding, we're spending $245,541. Mm-hmm. And I just think that that's a more true way for you guys to look at these line items. Mm-hmm. So going to the next page, we did add the $4,905 that we cut out of the textbook line. We did add that here in textbooks as a contingency. We can remove that. It's a transition year for Whately Elementary to have less textbook money. So that could be a temper, you know, we could use it only in contingency. And then again, there's no other, until we get to page 23, we pay $13,895 of our psychological services from school choice. And then if you look on page 26 of 28, you can see the totals going across the bottom, how much each will provide. So the town would be providing 80.37%, school choice 17.62%, 0.86 for the early childhood revolving, and the SPED 9242 would be 1.15%. The next page is the school choice fund. And the way I broke this out is on the left-hand column is what we projected and approved in FY16 to spend. Mm-hmm. So we had thought we would have an ending balance of $1,175. If you look on the actual, we only had $6,344. The revenue we thought was coming in at $281,066. The final number came in at $261,836. So right there with those two numbers, we were down about $25,000. And then you can look at each line item. So our initial expenditure was $278,503, but it's ballooned to $311,693 because we ended up paying the cafeteria deficit and we had some testing and supplies expenses that needed to be paid from the school choice fund.
Wasn't the cafeteria deficit higher than what you're showing here?
It was in the previous year, Don. The other year, we brought the $16,000 to bring the account to zero.
That was because I remember $16,000, and I'm like,
that was the year before. Now
it's showing three, and I'm going, wait a minute.
In FY15, we had to pay if the account was in the deficit and any bad debt that if parents still owed us money.
So this is money that families owed?
Or we were in deficit.
Or that we overspent.
We were in a deficit situation in our cafeteria.
How are we looking now for this year?
I'm going to be bringing that to you. Next month we have our joint meeting, mm-hmm. right? I'll have the information for you in April, but we'll be discussing it in May. And I do think it's something that we need to look at. None of our schools are doing well in school lunch. We are all losing money. And we need to either shore up our town appropriation budgets to keep all of our lunch programs separate and operating, or we need to do something radical and try to combine some of our lunch programs. We've got some difficult decisions ahead to make with the lunch program. So for 17, so at the end of this year, we're going to have, that's the wrong number, the 57, for projected 17 should be 43. I have to correct that. The wrong number.
So in the actual column, you have 43.
Right, and that should be the number that carries up to the beginning balance, the ending balance of 17. So it's a difference of... Why would I don't have my computer?
So I think just throwing out a general comment, next year I think it would behoove you to think about ahead of time percentage of money that's currently being used by school choice to go back on the budget. Because even if you have the same number of kids, costs are still going to go up and the deficit will just continue to get smaller. Or but bigger, I mean, I'm sorry.
I guess I'm still confused that if you go through, so if we go through 17, or we're in the black, or in the red already, the
correct.
Beginning of 17. So
for a year in arrears.
We spend in fiscal year 16, yeah. We're spending the money we earned in FY 15.
That's the 261?
Yes. So that is what we're going to spend this year. But we thought it was going to come in at 281.
But right. Because we had so we're five
down,
less
we're
students.
Down by that, by the
right.
smaller number,
and one
and
of
by
must...
the overages that we've already
correct.
Spent. So at the end of this year, we're over by 43, which we have to take from next year's money,
right.
which is the 243.
Correct.
559. And then, but then we're saying we're going to spend another
347. I
so
work this calculator.
So the question mark is how many school choice are we going to have next year and what is that number going to be?
Correct. So you have to make up at least six to give you exactly what you have now.
Mm-hmm.
Preferably, it would be nice to have 11 because that would put you to where you were last year.
Right.
How many slots do we have open? You anticipate?
Yeah, I would say we only have one class that's at 20 right now, and we have a very small kindergarten, 12, 13 kids there, and we always get most of our kids, you know, most of the numbers come in the kindergarten level. Our sixth grade will be closed because that's we have 20 kids, I think, in that's closed is up for discussion. I mean, we've always shot for 18 to 20, and that's what I've always done is try to figure out the overall amount and then not overburden any grade with kids. But
you have
in
20
every grade,
in your fifth grade now.
Yeah, so six. So if we, you know, if we stick true to our numbers, K through five, we'll all have openings. It's just a matter of, you know, at one to four openings in each grade. It's just a matter of, you know, where we'll get requests.
We do
advertise when we, in the spring. Right around this time of year, as a matter of fact, mm-hmm. we start thinking about advertising, and we normally don't advertise across grades. We'll usually say we'll have openings in the following grades if those are grades we want to target.
Do you know how many native kids we're expecting in next year's kindergarten class?
Not off the top of my head, but I don't think it's a lot.
Like five, six?
Yeah, I think it's less than eight.
Yeah.
So what is the process if a family wants to do school choice? Like how do we direct them or where would they go? They go to the website?
Or yeah.
They contact you?
They usually contact us directly.
Uh-huh.
Yep. And we send them
application
to complete. Parents stop by.
Uh-huh.
The way it works, Katie, is that they leave an application with us. They tell us how many kids they'd like to send and which grades they'd like to have them in.
Mm-hmm.
And around early May, we'll take a look at all those numbers and... we'll see which grades need a lottery. For example, you know, if we have eight kids coming to kindergarten and I have seven requests, you know, obviously no need for a lottery. We'll take them all.
Uh-huh.
Plenty of room for those kids. But in grades where we have maybe 17 students and five requests, we might only take three of those, you know, in order to stick mm-hmm. with our classroom size numbers, which is a school committee discussion, quite frankly, if mm-hmm. we wanted to increase and go, you know, over 20. As our target, which isn't to say we haven't been over 20 in the past, but usually that happens over time.
Mm-hmm.
I can tell you that in my six and a half, almost 7 years here now, we have never used a school choice slot to go over 20. If we've gone over 20, it's because maybe we had a fourth grade that had 19 kids, and by the time they became sixth graders, we got three residents, you know, and it went over. But I've never pushed the number over 20 with school choice kids. But certainly, that's a piece of the discussion we can have, although I would be reluctant to go much higher than that.
But it's worth mentioning that in your second grade, you have 17 kids, and 10 of them are school choice. So well,
that speaks to the number of local kids coming to school,
right.
Which is very low.
And we can check, and you know what we do is Rhonda will check with the town to see how many births we had last year, so we know how we can try and project what we'll have.
Rhonda
in 5 years.
Has that already.
Yeah,
she's already given that to me, and we followed up on trying to track the kids down because it is their census, and kids mm-hmm. move around, and that's why I say it's between 5 and 8. And they're doing kindergarten registration right now. So,
but I meant just last year, there was only 2 children more.
Right.
In Whately.
In Whately.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And do we have any worry that some school choice families might choice away from Whately? We don't know.
Nothing that's come to my attention, but again, that's
a risk also.
That's the same kind of question.
Theoretically, it's not a risk for us. If you say school choice kids
school choices. Kids go to another school.
You mean Whately kids?
Whately kids go to another school,
or if a school choice kid goes to another school, we lose that money,
right?
So that happened last year. We had a family from Sunderland, and they decided to return to Sunderland. So we lost those.
It's rare in Whately. I will say this is considered a very desirable school.
More common than that, Katie, is that a family will come to us as school choice while they're looking for a home in Whately. Mm-hmm. And then they become residents, and we still lose the money.
Right.
That happened twice this year.
That's often how it goes, is that we'll get contacted in the spring, and they say, we're moving this summer. Okay. And, of course, they don't find a house right away that summer. And, you know, October, November, December rolls around, and they finally move in. And, you know, we get 2 months of school choice, or they're here for 2 or 3 months, and then they become residents.
That's how close are you on negotiations to settling, you know?
We have another meeting on Wednesday. It is my sincere desire that we complete it on that day. We've been negotiating since October. So it may require another meeting, but I would hope that on the elementary level we're done by the end of March.
That's a long time.
So
6 months is a long time.
It is a very long time.
So the bottom line, instead of the 157, it would be 142,681, just so you can make that correction.
142,681. No, I know, I'm just saying.
So if next year's funding is the same as, if 18's funding is the same as, wait,
17,
I'm wrong with my years here, but if 17's funding is the same as what we're 16, expecting for 16,
right.
We'd only have $100,000.
In
that fund.
We're going to be in the negative. We're going to be spending $17 in 17. To get us through 17, we're going to spend all of 16's and half of probably what we bring in 17.
Right. We'd spend 142 out of the next 243, say, if it's 243.
Right. We would
leave
be short the one. Right, exactly.
The following year.
Yes. Yes.
So we're really got very little
right
for the next year.
Correct. So that's why I'm saying the town needs to anticipate that in 18, we're not going to have the money to fund these services that are funded by school choice. And as I said, they're necessary expenses. They're not extras because we have school choice students here.
Right. Which brings me back to, do we want to put a little more in the town budget this year to either anticipate that, or
you can make a motion?
I don't know. Question.
I don't know. Usually I have a sense of direction from the town as far as budget, and I don't this year, so I don't know what they're looking for, and I don't know what other competing interests are going on in the town that may cause people to look less favorably if it was a 2% increase or above. I don't know if either of you do.
I haven't heard a word from anybody what they're looking for.
All right. So
I mean, presumably they have a lot of the same personnel increases that
you
would.
I'm sure.
So that's the only thing I really know.
I just
What's your question, Don?
No, I'm losing my mind, I think, because PT, OT, school psychologists always used to be in the budget. They were in the budget. That's where I say I'm losing my mind, because I don't remember moving them out of the budget into school choice. I don't remember that.
I think that's because those decisions were made.
Was time increased for them?
No.
Okay, that was what I was wondering. If because of IEP's time was increased, that those additional pieces of the salary came out of school choice?
I guess I'm just saying that I think prior to my arrival, that there wasn't as much detail given. And as we've been trying to move our budget in a downward trend instead of an upward trend, we had been utilizing more of the school choice money. Now, I don't know if the school committee exactly said, move this position, move that position.
I do know that for years, when we did the old-fashioned budget books, there were positions that were not included in the budget books, and they were lumped into school choice. I did not have the detailed breakdown of what that included, but I do know that did occur. So it may be that this is just more transparent, Don.
I guess. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I know when I was here, those things were in the budget.
Okay.
And I just don't know when they got moved here, that's all.
Well, what's crowding them out, I guess? That's the question in the regular budget. So.
I think it was a matter of reducing our...
Yeah.
The bottom line. Exactly.
The bottom line for the appropriation to the town.
That's right.
I mean, that's my guess. I don't know, because I don't remember making that decision as a school committee member.
Mm-hmm. I think it was made before it would even get to school committee in years past, in an effort to reduce the budget.
Right. I think those positions have been paid for by other sources the whole time I've been here. So.
But the big shift now is we're sort of trading assistants, classroom assistants, for teachers in the school choice.
The bottom line is you're still doing salaries, which was never the intent when we started school choice. Mm-hmm. It was never the intent to shift budgeted pieces onto school choice. It was always to do the extras. And then, you know, we've had this discussion before, but when school choice became real dollars, like $50,000, $60,000, $70,000, mm-hmm. we did have pressure. Because I can remember when I was at Frontier, we had pressure from the towns. We have all the school choice money. You're sitting on that. Mm-hmm. Use that to reduce the budgets. And so that's what's happened.
And that is as it should be, because these children are, should be using the money we
receive.
Correct.
Okay. Correct.
Yeah. And I understand that.
Yeah. But I think the point is we can't, you know, and I could remember Don Scott saying, you're going to come to a point where you're just not going to have more and more school choice.
Well, next year's budget is going to be really hard.
Right. I mean, and it's not just Whately. This is going around in the other schools as well.
So while you were having that conversation, I did some quick calculations. If we were to take the school psychologist funding off of school choice, that would be $13,895. If we were to put that back on in our town appropriation, increase would be sitting at 2.23%, and our deficit in the school choice account would be $128,786. So adding $13,000 takes us from 135 to 223.
Yeah.
You know, we're only asking for an increase of $21,000.
The percentage looks,
You know, the percentage, when you look at the percentage versus the dollars, so we would be asking for about $35,000 more if we put the psychologist back on.
Right, but if you put all the pieces together, I like this way you laid it out, and you look at the increase from year over year, that's a big increase if you add all the pieces. Like, it's 25% increase in school choice.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's a huge increase.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I don't know, I didn't do the numbers on the overall increase, but... that's what we're really dealing with.
Correct.
Is that all the costs are going up.
Right.
It's not really where you're paying for it.
Right. And as Mr. Skrosky said, the salaries on school choice go up, but we still get the same $5,000 every year. And the only variance is sped increment and number of students. So it's hard to sustain people on a school choice budget. And then maybe what we should be doing is working to moving the staffing back onto the budget and moving non-staff back onto school choice. So the instructional software would come out of the budget, or possibly some of the alternative sped services that we need. Let's put that on.
The garden program
could go on, and we could bring the people back. I mean, if that's the way you would like me to do it, I can go and try to do, you know, it won't be a one-to-one switch because I don't know how much you want to go up in your town appropriation, but whatever direction you give me, I will absolutely go back and take a look at that.
Because we're not adding any positions to the budget.
No.
We're adding two halves into one to make one.
Yes.
Not only that, but I just want to be clear that, because I think I heard you say, you know, moving instructional assistants, that on page 8 of 28, that highlighted decrease, that's not money being moved to school choice. That's a decrease.
Right, those are real decreases.
That's right.
Those two.
Correct.
Right.
So I actually did do the math. If you add all the pieces together, it's a 4.5% increase year over year for all the pieces. Mm-hmm.
And that's what the budget was when we brought it to you last month. It was 4.56%.
So in some ways you'd want both parts to share in the pain.
And there could be
savings.
And
that's the reality. Right. And that's with cutting positions.
Right. Correct.
And that's with reducing where
we can. Yeah, there's no new programs, there's no new staffing.
I also just want to say, for the sake of the record, that those are reductions that are happening naturally.
There are
services that are going to be coming to a close, and that's going to impact the staffing. We're not cutting because of the budget.
Right.
We're lucky that we have
a
couple
of
natural reductions.
We have one student who's transitioning to Frontier, so we no longer need that IA. And as Pete just said, another one, the IEP has changed and no longer requires a one-to-one. So unfortunately, that means...
Or won't for next year. Mm-hmm.
So that means we're in less need of two IAs.
The other thing I want to ask, or at least put on the table, I don't need a response now, but one of the things that we haven't really in the past recruited school choice kids, besides one ad, which we haven't even done every year. But this year, if folks are in agreement, you know, unfortunately, newspaper ads are several hundred dollars a pop these days, but despite the budget freeze, if I'm directed to do so, or if you'd like me to do so, I'd be happy to do an ad a couple of times and indicate that we have openings K through 5.
Now, down where I live, the Springfield Republican once a year has a insert on just school stuff, and that is where we used to put our school. We would advertise in the school choice when they would do their annual, and they would take, you know, all the schools down in Hamden County.
They do it up here, but it's quite expensive
to put an ad in there.
Yeah.
I mean, I would encourage us to put a page on our website that outlines the school choice program. And I think people look a lot online just to get information.
You're right.
And I think just having to call the office is one obstacle that would, you know, might deter them. So if it's up there and the form is up there. Well,
I think it might be, Katie. I'm going to double check.
I don't know.
But
I
hear you.
That would be
the quicker
a great way
they
to
can,
get the word out there fairly cheaply.
The quicker they can print the form and send it to us.
And they can just search on school choice in the area.
I think we may already have the forms online, but I'll double check that. But I like your point that maybe just making it a front page, indicating that we have school choice openings right on our front page would be helpful too. But we can get back to the idea of whether we do a couple of ads before we get too much further into the spring.
So what is your pleasure? In a way, it's sort of feel the pain now a little bit or feel the pain next year?
Well, I'm sort of a newbie, so I defer to people that have been here
before. Well, I mean, it's just that I'm inclined to think maybe it's not a bad idea that we put that $13,000 back in the budget.
That's
come in with a little over two, and see how that flies. Because it's really going to stress us next year.
Next year is going to be terrible.
If we don't do that,
right.
I think we're going to be awful. And it's going to, I think it'll ease the burden on the town a little bit going into next year.
Yeah.
So we're kind of taking a little bit of a bite this year and a little bit bite next year.
And I think that's a manageable figure, 2.23. I think it's the right direction to go. knowing that next year you'll probably have to do the same or more.
Would you also like me to try and move people back on a town and move more things onto?
I'd rather these things onto
school choice
than bodies, because it's easier, a lot easier, to say, well, we just don't have the money to buy this piece of software, than it is to say that aide that's in the classroom.
It's been here for years.
Well, not only that, but the service that they're providing to our kids.
Mm-hmm. No, I can't promise I can do everything, because we don't spend a lot in things.
I understand, but my point is that it's much easier to deal with things than bodies.
Some ideas. I'd be glad to meet with you.
Yeah, we can absolutely.
And I would just encourage us to talk about the whole budget, like the 1.972 is the whole budget of what we're spending as compared to what we spent on the whole budget last year, because that's really the most important thing for people to understand.
So we're going to need an adjusted figure to vote on tonight.
For the town appropriation.
Right.
Start with that one salary, though.
Yeah, because everything else is going to be penny for penny swap.
I think that's the only way to go.
Mm-hmm. I'm more comfortable with that.
You know, that gives us a little breathing with the school choice. Mm-hmm.
And then maybe if we get more people in next year, then that would give us a little more
relief also. And still, the contract is not negotiated, so that could
a little there.
That could give us, and a little bit also the student, we don't know yet exactly.
We don't, So
the budget you would be voting tonight for town appropriation is of $1,599,454.
Okay, thank you. And that is now an increase of...
Let me just redo my math. It's hard to do on this little calculator.
There, there's 54. Okay. Because when we vote, that's the figure we got to use.
Mm-hmm. So you don't
2.23%.
Vote on the
whole,
you only vote on the town.
Okay.
We vote on what we're asking for the town.
2.23% and the I'm sorry, the total dollar increase.
The total dollar from last year would be $34,964.
Okay, instead of the $21,069.
Right.
Gotcha. Okay.
What was it?
$34,964. That is the increase over last year's budget.
I'm assuming Patty will give us a cleaned up copy.
Absolutely, and they will be paginated. Okay. Hey, I'm a wizard in PDF files now. I'm combining, I'm merging, so we have one set of page numbers.
So we have five more minutes before the public hearing. I didn't know if you had any more questions on any of the budget line items.
Yeah. Because I'm not going to be able to stay for the public hearing, unfortunately.
So if you have any more budgetary questions,
do you guys think you can handle the presentation about that?
I don't know. Any questions?
I think they're lining up at the door.
Any questions from anyone out there?
Oh, don't scare me, Pete.
I do know one person that's coming.
I do know one. Maybe.
But I think the narrative clearly tells the story of why the things are changing.
Okay. Let's go back to the agenda here for a second. Try to save some time. Under new business, we had an emergency sprinkler repair.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And refresh my memory, how much was that?
Oh, you
just
have the
warrant.
I think it was $1,300 or something.
Yes.
Yeah, $1,360.
And we do have money that was appropriated from the town for sprinkler repairs.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we just need to vote.
If you pass them down, Katie, I can look at them. And then the yellow folder, please, I'll be taking those with me. Hampshire Fire Protection, $1,796.72.
Where was that money appropriated from?
The sprinkler fund from the town of Whately.
Okay.
We had a leak in the dry system piping, and it was patched. And we now have also some extra piping that we kept up in the rafter. So if it happens again, we'll have the equipment here, and we'll be able to just fix it ourselves.
Okay. Do we need a motion to vote on that? I make a motion to vote on appropriating that money from the sprinkler fund.
I'll second that. All in favor? Aye.
And that's the first couple of leaks we've had in well over a year. You might remember a period of a couple of years where it seemed like it was springing a leak every other week. We've placed a lot of pipe.
Yeah.
All right, well, I'm going to take this brief recess, too.
Okay, you're going to keep those?
Pete's going to take them, and in case some public do show up, I'm going to leave them there.
That's great.
Is that yours or mine?
Well, but you know, the problem with they're not correct.
Do you want me to take them all away?
Well, we're here for a public hearing, at least.
They can get a sense.
Somebody shows.
We can edit it.
We know
all right.
Going to be changed.
And then you can toss them.
We know the numbers. We can share. I'll give you a call so we can get together and talk about
Wednesday would be better for me, Pete. I go to Frontier tomorrow.
No problem. Thank you.
Yeah, that was yours, Patty. I know. Although I'll take it, I'm taking extras for Bob Paul.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, Patty.
Thank you.
Thanks.
How quick is your report, Pete?
Pete's and mine are very quick, so.
Well, we've got a couple minutes.
Yeah, let's do it.
Who wants to go first?
I'll go first.
Okay.
So my notes are annotated, and I'm pretty much just telling you what's there, which is simply that I want to keep, I've been updating on the Climate Committee, I think, monthly this year. We had a parent forum on the 25th. We had six parents join us, as well as members of the Climate Committee were there. I presented an abbreviated version of the PowerPoint that was sent to us by the organization that we bought our product from, and that was really an overview of the survey results. Parents who were present were had good ideas. They offered both questions and suggestions for moving forward. The committee meets again tomorrow, and we are moving into the action plan part of this whole process. And over the next, we anticipate that we will use the rest of this year and all of next year for implementation. And by implementation, I mean we're going to keep doing some of the things that we've been doing, which we think are successful. We're going to make some changes in some other areas to improve those couple of discrete categories that got lower scores. And then we discussed possibly the following year having a repeat of the evaluation to see, you know, how things look then. But that would probably be FY18 in the fall sometime. But I just wanted to keep you updated on that. School council. Just to give you an update on where we are with our school council, we'll meet again at the end of this month on the 23rd. And I would like to present them, of course, with the budget. The school council has two primary roles. Katie, you know this from having been on it, is to help write the school improvement plan and to advise the principal on matters related to the budget. So I want them to have an updated budget. We do have a couple of openings, not openings, I shouldn't say it that way. We have two parents out of three that are in their second of 2 years. So they certainly are free to nominate themselves and run again if we need an election, but we will ask for nominations. That's the right way to do it, as well as two staff positions on the council that are also in their second year of 2 year terms this year. So if any of those people decide they don't want to continue, then we'll need nominations. But even if they do decide to continue, the right thing to do is to ask for nominations, and then if somebody wants to run, they'll run against an incumbent. But we'll discuss that at our next meeting. And that's really all I have for you from that perspective.
Can I ask about the hiring for the new positions? Mm-hmm. What the process is for that? Are there sort of hiring committees, or how does that work?
Right now we're collecting applications for the school psychologist position, mm-hmm. but we haven't formed a committee yet. I suspect that Karen Ferrandino will have a role with me on that.
She, with the district?
She's
no. SPED director.
SPED director.
Okay.
Yeah, SPED director. We will soon be posting, just before April break, we'll post that first grade position. We have not put a committee together there yet, mm-hmm. either. The Spanish And the, I already said the psychologist job.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The Spanish position was posted already, and we have, we got one applicant, and that's someone in district who we really hope to bring over. What am I forgetting?
Nurse.
And the school nurse position is also, has also been posted, and we had an applicant there. It's actually the person who's been our long-term sub, and we hope to continue with that person as time goes on. I think that'll be the way that'll work out.
So who do you involve in the committees when you... I have a committee.
It really depends on the position, you know. Usually with the first grade position, it'll probably be myself, Louise Law, and a couple of staff members. Not sure who. Yeah, we haven't formed it.
Yeah, it depends. The school psychologist is a little trickier. Mm-hmm. Probably would be the special ed director and the principal.
Uh-huh. Maybe a psychologist
and
from
maybe
another school.
Yeah, a psychologist from another school. Okay. So.
Those do you ever involve parents?
Never involve parents in teaching positions.
Yeah. Principals, superintendents,
yeah, curriculum
parents.
Directors. Yeah, you have parents involved for principal search, any kind of central office position or head of school position.
It is 7:03. But we have no public. We have. Wait a minute. I'm getting there, Marty. We have no public here. So, in the interest of continuing our meeting, I am going to ask you to present your report.
I thank you. I'm sorry. I thought
and
you were
I wasn't
going to
cutting you off.
Well, actually, I've talked about most of it already to you, so I'll just be very abbreviated. In November and December, we had to do a district self-assessment, and this involved all of the programs pre-K through 12. And we uploaded hundreds of pages of documents from the Department of Ed, and we were informed recently that they're only coming to audit Frontier. So they arrived today, and they will be here today, tomorrow, and Wednesday. And I asked about the likelihood of them coming to audit the elementary schools at any time in the near future, and they said highly unlikely. So I was very pleased about that. On Friday, the Franklin, Hampshire, and Hampden County superintendents, we met with local legislators, and we had 16 who showed up, four state senators and 12 state representatives. It's nice to have a captive audience. I sat with Steve Kulik and Stan Rosenberg and got the chance to ask him about charter cap lifting and regional transportation. We talked about early childhood education, some of the trends we're seeing. And so they're very good politicians, but it was nice for them to hear some of our concerns and perspectives. And I also wanted to just mention that we have formed, Mike Bonacani is superintendent at Mohawk. We have our first meeting March 23rd, a consortium of rural schools. What we're looking for is some sort of differential in the funding formula for rural schools. So I'm hoping that my successor will continue with that, because I think there's a lot of merit to it. I know they're experiencing some of the same population declines in the Berkshires at a much steeper level than we are. And Bob isn't here tonight, but I wanted to publicly thank people who've been participating in the negotiations. As I said, we started in October. I'm hoping to wrap it up. It has involved hours and hours and hours of people's time. So I appreciate them staying with the process. So that's what I have, Mr. Skrotsky.
All right. That pretty much closes out our regular school committee meeting.
Mm-hmm.
I think we'll just move into a hearing. So I will ask that the superintendent give us an overview of the proposed budget.
Sure.
In the absence of Ms. Kavanaugh.
And I'm wondering, Pete, if I could ask you, we have a couple of people in the audience to pass these to.
And we welcome the audience. It's a rarity to have an audience at a public hearing at a school committee meeting. So I'm pleased that we have a selectman as well as a finance committee member. So thank you both for coming.
So if you want to walk through, I'm going to skip the superintendent's budget message. You can read that anytime you want to. Pages 4 through 28 of the budget go over the narrative, and they talk about the salary increases and decreases. I can read through these. We have a committee have just gone through this, but I think it might be better if we skip to page 8 of 28, which really just gives you the listing of the data that is presented in the narrative. So if you look at the top, we have an increase in the cost of negotiated steps of $12,729. An increase in the cost of the degree changes, these are all teachers who informed us of degree changes, of $660. We have a couple of people of our IAs who are entitled to their longevity benefit of $750. We are requesting that we increase the daily sub rate from $65 to $75 per day. We are the lowest in Franklin, Hampshire and Hamden County, and we're finding it increasingly more difficult to obtain subs. We are just changing the funding for art and music. Before, partial of that was on a grant, and now we have to put things on the budget. Same thing for the early childhood teacher. And this is the trend too, this is basically for members of the public, that we're seeing our grants either go away or decrease in amounts. So we're starting to have to shift more things, which had been picked up by grants in the past, to the budget. And then we do have number of teachers retiring, so anticipated salaries if we hire at a lower scale of $31,478. And I skipped over a big one, which was the decrease of two full-time instructional assistants of $44,797. So total salary-related increases are minus 0.22%, or $19,048. And then there are some operational increases. We have some central office expenses. Again, these were people who were paid out of a grant, and that grant no longer exists, so we had to shift that to the budget. We do have an increase of out-of-district tuitions. We are anticipating this. We're waiting for the 45-day evaluation to see if that is coming to fruition. The garden program is a program that has been in place for a number of years. We are just shifting the funding because it had been picked up on a grant. Medical and health services. These are services that we just have never really had a line item for. These are things like additional rubber gloves, calibrating the AEDs, EpiPens, just things that we've always had to spend, but we have never had a line item for. The building and maintenance supplies actually reflects what our true costs are. We have overspent that line, so we're adding more to that. And because we do not have a negotiated contract yet, in anticipation of that, insurances, contract adjustment requirements. And then other operational decreases, decrease in school committee legal expenses. This is because we've gone with a new firm, and their costs are less than the previous one. Because of Whately's enrollment, there's a decrease in the central office percentage from 9.43 to 9.11. Decrease in building heat of 6,000. Decrease in special ed transportation. Decrease in regular transportation. We have shifted things because we are not buying textbooks like we have in the past. We have decreased that by $4,905, and a decrease in sped instructional services of $1,500. So this summary of pages represents an increase of the budget of $21,069, or 1.35%. However, after we went through our discussion, one of the concerns that we have had and that school committee has had is that we have been spending more and more of our school choice dollars to try to offset and come in with a very low budget to the towns. And the problem is that our school choice, last year we had 49 students. This year we have 44. So we have applied salaries to the school choice expenditures. The salaries continue to go up. The school choice only continues to pay us $5,000. It never goes up. And we've reduced it. So one of the recommendations that has not been voted on, one of the recommendations by the school committee tonight was to take a portion, a $13,000 and change, that is currently being used to pay for a school psychologist and put that back on the budget. So the recommendation was to have the budget come out to a total increase of 2.23%, or a total increase of $34,964. The reason for that is that if we keep spending more of the year in arrears, we are eventually not going to have anything in, if you want to call it, a rainy day fund. So that next year would be fairly extreme. So to outline this just a little bit further for you, if you go to page
27.
Thank you, Donald. Go to page 27. I'll wait till you get there. What this does is this gives you further detail about the projected school choice funds. So if you look at the top for FY16, we had a projected ending balance of $11,785. We had a projected revenue of $281,066. In actuality, what we had was a projected ending balance of $6,344, and our revenues came in less than we anticipated of $261,836. So if you had five students left than we had from last year to this year, and you're getting $5,000 per student, that's a $20,000 difference. But if you keep on that spending pattern and keep having the positions that you see listed here assigned to school choice dollars, that expense is going to grow because salaries grow and the school choice dollars are going to continue to be depleted. We could have left it as it is and come in and at the 1.35%, but next year I think the increase to the budget would look pretty extreme. So I don't know if school committee would like to echo or chime in on anything.
Well, just the last part you said, Marty, we could come in with a budget a little over 1%. And that looks good for going into 17. But when we go into 18, we're going to be hurting with school choice. So that means that we're going to come back to the town for more money. I think to ease the burden on the school and the town, that we take it in baby steps, we add a little bit to our budget. So it increases to 2.2, whatever it is, and it's less of a burden the following year in FY18. So that's our reasoning. There might be those out there that say, well, we want to keep it at the 1.4 or whatever it was. But I really think the real physically sound thing to do is to try and ease into it a little bit rather than take the full burden in FY18.
And I would just add, if you look at the increase in the school choice budget, that's closer to 20% increase in that piece of the budget. So it's really bearing the brunt of the increase. if you add all, if you go to the page before and you look at the bottom line, all these different numbers, that's the town piece is the first 1.5 million, then the school choice is the 347, and then there's two other sort of fund sources of funding. So the full budget is 1.972, and that's a 4.5% increase overall from last year. So the town is still getting a bit of a break in terms of the overall increase on the budget, even at 2.23%.
So that's what it is, 2.23%?
For that one, that change, yeah.
2.23, yeah.
I think that the concept that you lay out is the smart concept, because you don't want to wipe out your cushion, mm-hmm. if you will. I guess my only question, it's not related to this budget so much as structural budgets moving forward and going backwards. When we get grants, most grants that I've ever seen, unless you're going to tell me that for some reason these grants don't project a sunset, have a sunset. And I think that it may make sense when we go after these grants in the future that allow us to fund certain positions, great programs, great positions, mm-hmm. that we need to be clear with the citizens that this grant for this art and music teacher, and I don't want to pick on art music, but right. it came to mind. It will run out, and we probably, if history is an indicator, are not going to have the stomach to let this person go, nor do we want to, because art and music is important. So, and let's say that we were getting the grant for the first time in 2017, in fiscal 2017. I think it's only fair to tell people, and this grant will go away in 2020. And that means that we are going to be getting an increase in our overall budget ask because of the sunsetting of that grant. Because otherwise, again, because people look at things on a year-to-year basis, mm-hmm. they're not getting fooled into it, but they're like, okay, this is fine for this year, because that's their job to look at it for this year. It's not their job to look what happens in 3 years. So I just think that it's to not get caught in this situation. And the same thing happens with town budgets, I mean with non-school budgets, that we need to be very honest with ourselves about what decisions we're going to be forced to make when the grant sunsets.
I agree, and I would say that it used to be much more problematic when there were more grants. We used to have a lot of enhancement grants. The grants we get now, we get Title I funding, we get REAP, we get a little bit for early childhood. They are so minuscule. We used to get grants for major programs to do lovely things. But because our free and reduced lunch numbers are so low, because our MCAS scores are relatively high, those are often the quick qualifiers. We don't qualify for almost anything. But that did used to be a problem, because we'd get a 2 to 3 to 5 year grant, and we would put this person on it, and everybody would love the program, and they'd say, oh, it's a budget buster. We have to add it to the budget the next year. I have not seen that to be problematic because the grants have gone.
But we're facing it now.
With school choice.
Explanation.
Right.
Well, the other part of that is yeah. that in, to ease budgets in the past, you dipped into school choice.
Right.
And, you know, the other argument is on the public side is that these kids are costing us money, the school choice kids are costing us money in the school. Why aren't you using more of your school choice?
Mm-hmm.
So it's a, you know, it's a catch 22 for the school committee and the administration.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's not a good.
And I'm just saying that yeah. we're getting to the point that if we don't start to back off a little bit on our school choice, then it's going to be problematic, because the things that we want to keep in the budget, we won't be able to unless they're appropriated by the town.
Yeah. Just back off on the funding, the school choice
yeah.
funding. We want more school choice if we can get it, to get more people
right.
to come.
Right. So it's just to be mindful of it, because we're all vying for the same students.
Right.
In the valley, the population is going down, and so, you know, I had said earlier when school choice first came about, it was sort of extra money. It was what we used to buy some stuff, and then it became real dollars, and there was a lot of pressure from the townspeople, as Don said, to have school administration use it to come for a lower figure. Well, we've done that. We're now funding people, a lot of people. So one of the things we talked about tonight was to try to shift some of that funding to have more of the personnel be put back on the budget and stuff as much as we could onto school choice, which I think is a good way to do it.
Can I ask another question? Jim, I don't want to get out of here. Actually, I have a couple more.
The out-of-district tuitions of the, you know, the additional 1.73, where is the... Where is the line item, and it just is reminding me of it, where is the line item for special education costs to the town? Because I'm wondering, is that offset by the 75% circuit breaker or 80%, whatever it is?
You have to spend well over, the cutoff for the state is about $40,000. You have to spend four times that amount.
Right.
We're not spending that.
So we're not getting much.
We're not getting anything in circuit breaker.
And where's that line item? I'm just curious.
I'm just trying to find it.
And I'm not saying, I understand that it's not something that's negotiable.
I'm just looking for special ed.
That's what I'm doing. I'll be honest with you. We've gone to a new budget format, and so it's a little more difficult for me because things where they used to be aren't there. So.
Broken out.
I don't think it is.
You just strikes me that it's one that should be.
What is it you're looking for exactly?
The out of district special ed costs.
I was at the bottom or something.
Or the, not the out of district, but just the sped costs that are sometimes reimbursable.
I think we're not seeing it because we don't have it at the moment. You know, none of our regular day-to-day costs are reimbursable. It's only when you have, you know, one or two students that are in very expensive places.
You don't have that situation right now.
That $27,000 is an anticipated expense.
Yeah, it's on page 17 of 28.
So other than that.
Okay. So if you go to it, it says payment to other districts.
Yeah.
Pete is absolutely right. We have a student who is out on a 45-day evaluation.
And that cost is this year's budget.
And we're we don't know what that result is. And you have no students currently out of district.
Okay. So, but we'll know by town meeting whether that, or we won't know by town meeting.
We should know by town meeting.
Because that'll impact, obviously, the budget.
Right.
You'll know one way or the other. And I guess my only other question is that
we're having a retirement this year in guidance. What's the plan?
We have a retirement in guidance / Spanish. And the plan is to combine the positions. There's a narrative on that into a full-time
psychologist
counselor. And the narrative on that is on page...
So is there a savings there at all?
There will be a bit higher at a lesser salary scale.
But you're not reducing an FTE?
They're not reducing the FTE.
No.
The bigger savings are bringing in new staff at a lower starting point than the people that are retiring.
And that was the $31,000 that was on the summary of changes page, on the first page that I read.
I just think that would be a place to share with other schools, potentially, you know, half-time counselors, like you do with PE.
It's tough to do when somebody else doesn't need a shared position, so.
It's also important to note that our counselor is, because she teaches Spanish, she's here 4 days a week, teaches Spanish one of those days. So we have a 3-day a week counselor. And then our psychologist is here 2 days a week. So we're looking for somebody full time who can do that whole job. Yeah. And honestly, those are services that are well used right now. I would be reluctant to see either reduce. Our school council plays a critical role in our building, you know, and again, 3 days a week. And school psychologist, obviously, with testing and student services, is 2 days a week. So, I mean, it's, I think it's staffed appropriately at the moment. But, and the Spanish position is one we're going to bring back with one person 1 day a week. We don't want to lose that either. But that's all in this budget at the moment.
So this budget represents no added programs, no added staff, and a reduction of 2 full-time instructional assistants.
And how could you do that?
Because the IEPs that these assistants served changed.
We have 2 students that have one-to-one assistant this year. One of them is graduating. The other one, we don't anticipate that need for next year. So yeah, those would have happened naturally, despite the budget.
I know it's early in the budget season, but we were talking about it earlier in our meeting. If we had any sense from the town, you know, what they're looking from the school in terms of something, of what is reasonable. And I don't know if the finance committee's gotten to a point where they have an idea what their expectations are with all the budgets as well as the school.
But I think this is a fairly fair budget. I think it will maintain what we currently have without adding anything, and hopefully not adding an undue burden to the taxpayers. I would love to be able to come in some year, or have somebody come in some year and say, we're going to add these new programs, we're really excited about this new curriculum. And because of budgets, because we have so few funding sources, we have the town and then a very small amount with grants. So, but we are very mindful of the needs of the taxpayers as well.
Yeah, I see no red flags. I frankly need to digest this a little bit before I can, you know, come up with some intelligent questions. When you meet with the finance committee, there may be there's more questions at that time.
What we will do, because this budget does not reflect the increase of the additional $13,000 or to the 2.23%. We can email the updated budgets. We usually do it to Mark Perhensky, and then he can distribute. I don't know if that makes sense.
That works.
That works? Okay.
You know, someday I'd like to see a budget that does ask for a big increase, because I think it's too bad when we have an increase in a budget with no additional programs.
Right.
And at some point, we need to have a conversation about how do we keep up with what we should be offering, and at what cost will mm-hmm. that be to the town mm-hmm. so that we can do justice to the students? Because I don't think budget increases with no additional programming is in the best interest of the students. I mean, we're not adding to the value proposition.
You mean significant increase?
I mean significant.
Every year you're going to have your cost.
Yes, no, that's what I'm talking. I'm saying, at some point, maybe we should fight for significant increases, and then and sell it with, and look what we're going to get. Mm-hmm. It's not a static curriculum and series of programs. It's a dynamic one. And I think at some level that's a more fair fight than the small increases with no programmatic mm-hmm. increases.
Well, you're always going to have. You know, you're always going to have.
I get that. I totally get that. But right. we
we never seem to be able to ask for the big ask that will really put us on a map that shows growth in what we're providing education.
Right.
Because we are stuck with, you know, the smaller increases and, mm-hmm. you know, half the school choice, and it's tough to raise taxes when half the
You're preaching to the choir.
Oh, I understand that. But what I'm saying is just, I'm not speaking for the select board, I'm speaking for one individual on the select board. But that's a fight, a battle, a whatever you want, a debate, that would be fun to wage.
Mm-hmm.
Because you could say, okay, we're going to do, and Pete, you and I have talked about, we're going to do a gifted and talented program.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to cost us X.
A math coach, a writing coach, you know, things like that.
Whatever, for the kids who really are excelling.
Mm-hmm.
So that you can really challenge them. You know, we're going to fight for full-time Spanish instead of one day a week Spanish. So that we're really going to teach them the language as opposed to... Not what we're doing is bad, but you get my point. We should work together to have that discussion across town in terms of really providing the value proposition, because mm-hmm. that's going to attract more school choice kids too. When we can show we're investing in this school because we want everyone in the region to come to this school.
But, I shouldn't say but, because that sounds like I'm opposed to what you're saying, but I'm not. But you have to keep in mind that school choice caps itself out yeah. at a point, because you can only allow so many school choice kids in a classroom and keep it at a reasonable size.
Right.
And we try to maintain 20. You know, that's our max out.
Never mind that the reimbursement hasn't changed in 20
ever.
Or it would be more people would be moving to town.
Right.
Because they want education there rather than just that's farming their kids here.
Right.
Because they
right.
want the education.
Or you have school choice kids and their parents decide to buy a house in town.
Exactly.
And then you lose that that money.
But you get another vote. For
yeah, that's true. Hurrah! Yeah, we got it.
But I'd like to have that conversation at some point mm-hmm. to really work towards what
we really can knock the ball out of the park with in terms of value, a larger value add.
Usually finance committees tell me nothing over two.
Oh, right.
You know, and that's usually the directive that I get. And so that limits sometimes your creativity as far as what you think the town will be able to swallow.
I think that's
your point. Then you have a discussion with the finance committee about what we need.
Right.
It all boils down to the impact on the tax rate.
Right.
Yep.
I know
that's
that.
That's what it boils down to.
Yeah. All right. Do you have any other questions? If not, we'll make sure you get copies, you know, through Mark, mm-hmm. and we'll meet again anyways on the 22nd.
Good. Thank you very much.
Thank you guys
Thank you.
For coming
Thanks.
In.
Thank you.
All right. Moving back to our agenda, since we are getting to the time of year that we need to let the town know what our proposal is, it could always be amended on the town meeting floor at a lower rate if
okay.
necessary.
Yep.
We can't increase our proposal, but we could decrease
lower it. Uh-huh.
So I would entertain a motion to establish our budget at the 2.2%?
2.23%.
Yeah.
Okay.
An increase of $34,964.
For a total of
$1,599,454.
Okay. So I'll make a motion
to do that.
And I'll second that motion. And hearing no further discussion, we'll put it to a vote. Aye.
All in favor?
Okay. All right. So I think that about ends our meeting for this evening. Let someone have something
to
else.
Motion to adjourn at 7:35.
All right. All in favor?